Right. So when you talk about like phytonutrients, one of the things that I really need to think about is like, well, you know, you know, like for example, rosemary. Well, I am not just going to like share, just eat rosemary. So I was like just curious as to how like the culinary arts are kind of like integrated into like this sort of whole approach.
Yeah, so the question was, how does the culinary arts integrate into these phytonutrient principles? That's the next sort of step that I'm taking this whole thing, right? In the Western world, we have lost touch with how to consume herbs properly. So let's take the example of rosemary, right? Rosemary has a very different chemical profile at when you compare new leaves to even leaves that were dried for like 1 or 2 days, right? And they have different phytonutrient profiles when you look at the tip of the rosemary plant as opposed to one closer to the base, right? And these are certain things that you wouldn't know that unless you read this paper on like these characterizations, right? And so you bring up a good point, right? The people that are really well versed on this are people that know how to cook and know how to prepare foods. But even some chefs don't know how to prepare foods in a way that preserve phytonutrients. For example, like if you consider olive oil, a lot of people use olive oil. Olive oil is like, you know, really healthy, right? But if you overheat olive oil, it denatures. So all of those like really good oils that are as a part of it, they denature as part of the heating process. And then, so you'd have to know like, okay, if I heat it above like, and the temperature threshold for that is actually 160 degrees. These are all things you would know only if you really like study these topics in depth. And I tried to like throw in as much of these little key points and pointers into the text that I wrote, the Phyto Diet Primer. But I think you're right. I think at some point there's gonna be this push among like, you know, culinary circles. And there already is to some extent, like you've heard of places like True Food Kitchen. That's like a wellness kitchen. It's very wellness forward, right? You're gonna start to see a more systematic way of preparing foods. I will say this, if you look to even like 1 or 2 generations ago, there were people in families making salves, they were making teas, they were making potions to try to like heal people. They're all phytonutrients. All these things are phytonutrients. So we had a better understanding of how to do this, like when we were growing our own food, when we were preparing our own food. Now that we've sort of lost touch with it, like, you know, here we are on our phones ordering food from ghost kitchens now. Like we're so far removed from the process of cultivating food and preparing food that it's affected the way we actually eat and consume these nutrients.
Mm-hmm. So I remember reading things like your liver resets itself every 21 days or something, and like it kind of seems like if you like start eating a completely new diet, like your body will just completely reset itself. And I'm kind of wondering, like, to what extent does the food that you ate like years ago have an impact on your health?
Yeah, so the question is, the liver regenerates itself every 21 days. And to what extent cumulative bad decisions on food have on the liver? The liver is an interesting organ. It has the ability to regenerate, certainly. But there is a point of no return. And that point of no return is when you have cirrhosis or scarring that's so bad that you can't heal. Okay, and this is the number one cause of liver transplant, actually. It's not alcoholism anymore, it's actually fatty liver. When you first start to see fatty liver, it's super early in the process, and you'll see fatty liver with alcohol. You'll also see it in non-alcoholic fatty liver due to poor diet. And these effects can be cumulative. Now, your question is probably like, how do you judge whether something is reversible versus not? And there are these things called fibro scans, and it's a way, like when you end up reviewing some of these clinical documents, there's ways that they grade the extent of liver injury. And there's different scores that they use to determine like how bad the liver is. And beyond a certain score, there's a likelihood associated with that of whether it's gonna recover versus need something like a transplant. So that's the complicated answer. But and so there are clinical ways of determining that.
I was wondering, when you meet patients and with chronic diseases and you present the more traditional method approach, how receptive are they to like incorporate lifestyle changes or diet changes, or like how likely are they to follow through?
So the question is, how receptive are people towards these types of dietary and risk factor modification? I see two types of patients in my clinic. One are people that definitely need surgery, okay? very obvious, okay? And then I see these people with sort of these inflammatory disorders or nonspecific symptoms that could be aided with the diet. And with these people, I propose this idea. It's a very long discussion. It's not one that happens within like 5 or 10 minutes. So it's a long discussion. I present to them my approach and I give them a trial period. And the trial period lasts about 6 weeks. And in those 6 weeks, I'll be able to differentiate people that want to do something versus not want to do something. And the people that don't want to do something, they're sort of looking for pills, more tests, more visits. Like, they're not really interested in getting better, right? But then of those people, there's going to be a subset of people. And I would say it's probably around 80% of people that go to the doctor actually want to do better. They'll at least make some attempt at fixing these problems, okay? And they'll either follow the diet 50%, they'll follow the diet altogether, or they'll do it for a couple weeks, then fall off. So if I start to see some progress, I could coach them at subsequent visits to try to get them back on this protocol, the mind-gut immunity protocol, right? Because if they can successfully complete this, their symptoms will get better in a matter of weeks. Like, they'll see immediate results. It's not one of those things where they'll wait 3 months or 6 months. They'll see immediate results. So that's kind of like the motivation. And I'll tell you this, by the time they come and see me, they've already like been through the gamut. So they already know what's out there. They're not naive consumers of healthcare. They're very seasoned consumers of healthcare. So they've already seen other doctors, they've already seen other methods not work, and they're kind of at their wit's end and just sort of willing to try anything. So those are like the two types of patients I see.
Yeah, I had a question. I'm curious how you put together your Phyto diet checklist. I've done like green tea polyphenol research in the past, mm-hmm. and how it affects neuronal like protection. And I'm curious to see like how does concentration of different phyto diets affect like your ability to regenerate or your ability to, like you said, it's somewhat immediate, right? Like how does that kind of play into like one's health?
Yeah. So the question was how did I determine the checklist? And is it based on any data specifically related to the concentration of these polyphenols or phytonutrients in the diet? The answer on the data question is a hard no, right? If there was a way to quantify the amount of phytos in somebody's diet or someone's food, that would be ideal, but that would require basically doing an in-depth analysis of literally everything that went into your mouth. Like, it would require a research lab to do it. So that option's off the table. And there's a ton of variables that affect phytonutrient levels. Like, for example, green tea polyphenols. If you heat the green tea to above 180 degrees, for example, or above 200 degrees, the polyphenol profile changes significantly. It ends up being more towards the tannins as opposed to the catechins and these other things. So it alters the profile completely, right? So even subtle changes like 1 degree, 2 degrees of the water, or how long you're letting it steep, or what type of tea leaf you happen to be using, these are all like variables. And unfortunately, these variables are not easily defined. They're literally, there's thousands of different types of tea. There's thousands of different like temperature settings and combinations of steep time, right? So you kind of have to like use judgment. And that also obviously means that some of this checklist is just my best guess as to what I think people can achieve. But proof is in the pudding, right? Like if you follow this and you get better and you feel better, great. That's the evidence, right? The evidence of what it works is the clinical evidence. Now, if you were to like subdivide this out and try to study it out, I don't think you're ever going to get to a point where you'll be able to judge like the number of phytos in someone's diet. I think that'd be very hard to do.
When you sort of had this revelation during, I think, medical school, do you know if you like, was it mainly just you trying to figure it out yourself, or did you also consult? I know you mentioned you went through like diagnostic processes like suggested by your own professors and whatnot. Mm-hmm. Did any of them like sort of steer you this way, or how did you get like inspired to search this specific group of tradition, like a combination of traditional and multicultural therapies?
Yeah, when I was in medical school and I got sick, I was really fed up. I had rheumatologists, I had gastroenterologists, I had endocrine specialists, neurologists, I had dermatologists looking at me, right? So, you know, biopsies, CAT scans, MRIs, EEGs, colonoscopies, blood tests, right? One thing after another. And everybody in those visits were just looking at ruling out or ruling in their one specific disease. And I ended up coming out with like a bunch of different diagnoses, right? But then with those diagnoses, what's the treatment plan? The treatment plan, like, you know, for something, for example, inflammatory bowel disease, was taking a medication that's an anti-inflammatory. That's the solution. The solution was not, let's try to figure out why this happened, let's try to figure out how to prevent it. Same with the allergies, same with the fatty liver, same with the rashes, same with the migraines. There was never this effort to try to figure out why. Like, I was a normal walkie-talkie kind of guy just a year prior to that, right? And so there wasn't this effort to try to figure out what happened. So I got fed up. That's the short answer. And the long answer was, I've always been somebody that's just a voracious reader. Like, I speed read through a ton of papers in a given night. So thus far, I've read almost like 10,000 papers on this topic. It's like that in depth of, like, I've read a lot. And even back then, I was just reading thing like paper after paper after paper when it got published. It was just being a little bit attention to detail. It wasn't anybody really saying one thing or another. Back in those days, gut health wasn't as big of a topic as it is now, right? And we don't have the probiotic options back then like we do now. Like right now, you can buy a specific species of probiotic from a grocery store. And it's not even just the species, it's a species with a number next to it and a patent next to it, which tells you, like, okay, they've got clinical data behind this, right? I wasn't even able to do that back in those days, right? So it's just really interesting. The process was painstaking, it was arduous, it was a lot of trial and error, you know? Like, I was even trying like gluten-free diets, FODMAP diets. There's all these other diets that are like pretty like big in clinical medicine. I was trying them all and like getting nowhere, right? And the real thing was, like, you know, I was sort of missing the boat on this, I think, really. So it was an arduous process, took years to perfect. Once it was perfected, I felt great.
Any other questions? Okay, can we give Dr. Sari another round of applause?
Okay, great.